I'd like to thank Lingua Pax for the kind invitation. Will you just allow me a little word of introduction? Coming to Catalonia makes me feel at home for more than one reason. First of all, there's a historical link because we were once part of the Spanish Empire. But more importantly, I think, you will see why through a little anecdote, which I will tell. As a young boy in colonial Malta, I was once passing beneath the window of a house where an English boy was peeping out. And as he saw me pass by, he shouted at me, "Maltese dog," and spat at me. And at that moment, instead of feeling angry, I felt ashamed. That experience marked my whole life. I'm sorry. And it made me wonder why I shouldn't have been angry. And here, well, we lived through independence. I'm sorry. But you will see, I am the generation which experienced independence. My colleague and friend, Thomas, he was born long after independence, so you have two generations, and you will see also certain different approaches. But in the history which we will present, you will see some of the reasons for. So let's start with our presentation. The geographical position of Malta, you know, at the geographical center of the Mediterranean. You have the distance from southern Sicily and Tunisia, and the total area there, 246 square kilometers, 67 square kilometers. You will think this is a non-entity, but still we have the privilege now of being a proud, I would say, independent nation. The population at 2014, the latest census, is 429,000, roughly, of which 28,000 are non-Maltese, and we acquired independence in 1964. In the constitution, the independence constitution, the national language is defined as Maltese, and Maltese and English are defined as official languages. Allow me a little historical overview. In Malta, we're used to a long tradition of the contemporaneous presence of more than one language. 218 BC, when Punic Malta passes peacefully under Roman rule, the languages were Punic, of course, and Latin and Greek as the language of prestige. But there is evidence to show that even from the Bronze Age, when the Phoenicians first came to Malta, around 800 BC, there was peaceful coexistence between the two cultures and presumably also between the two languages. The Bronze Age language, we do not know what it was, anyway, that's coming down towards more recent times, 60 AD, St. Paul's shipwreck, and the beginning of the Christianization of Malta, which lasted almost 400 years. We had a lot of upheaval following the Vandals and the Ostrogoths, northern Africa, Sicily. But by 535, we became part of the Byzantine Empire. And this was followed, 870, by Arab rule. And here, it's the only period in our history where we didn't have multilingualism, but we only had the glossia, presumably. In other words, two different varieties of the same language, classical and not African Arabic. 1091 sees the Normans coming to Malta, but the diglossic situation and the culture was unchanged. However, in 1127, Count Roger the Norman, who had taken Malta, his son consolidates Norman rule, introducing Latin Christianity and bringing over migrants from southern Italy and Sicily, so that Maltese Arabic starts to be exposed to Romance linguistic varieties. Then we have 1194, Malta passes under Hohenstaufen rule, 1248, Frederick II exiles Maltese Muslims to mainland Italy. Now, the survival of Maltese is indirect evidence that many Maltese Arabs converted to Christianity to avoid exile. Classical Arabic was no longer transmitted to following generations because, as Christians, they couldn't, of course, keep their religion. And so classical Arabic turns to Old Maltese, fusing lexical and grammatical elements from Arabic and Romance into one linguistic system. And this process continues under the Angevins and the Aragonese. This is just an example to show you how Maltese is born out of the fusion of the two linguistic streams. So there you have, Om umissir kujinui, marduf salt, hadom il klinika, ushtralom il medicina. The most dramatic example of this, of course, is our word for father, which in all Arabic dialects is bu, abu, baya, baba, but in Maltese it's completely unknown and it's messir, messere. So foreign emigrants marrying Maltese girls and anyway, and you have the translation there. 1530, the arrival of the Knights of St. John, and of course this brings increased pressure of Romance on the development of Maltese. And there you have our oldest continuous text in Old Maltese. It's called the Cantilena, from a document dating to 1530, but the author died about 40 or 50 years before that, so it's much older. Now, under the Knights, Italian emerges as the language of administration, the law courts, what little educational system there was, and the church. So, for the educated higher class of Maltese, Italian fulfilled the high function, whereas the low function was fulfilled by Italian and Maltese, whereas for the masses, the uneducated masses, you had only a monolingual situation. Following the brief French interlude, you might not know that we had Napoleon in Malta. Malta passes under the British crown, and immediately the British start to try to anglicize Maltese culture by imposing English, but this was completely unsuccessful for almost a century. So under British rule, Italian preserves its high functions. Also, the colonial attempts to impose English created a reaction which served as a rallying point for the emergence of nationalism. Not only that, we had some, this Royal Commission here, very exceptionally, the commissioners were favorably disposed to Maltese, but it was an exception, and they favor demands for the reopening of schools, access to government employment, and freedom of the press, but this was really an exception. It recognizes Italian as the language of the Maltese. Italian is the language of the Maltese, save for familiar conversation. 1849, there was a constitution, and Italian and English are both admitted as languages for discussion. There's no mention of official or national, just that they're admitted as languages for discussion in the Council of Government. Now, when Italy was united, 1861, the English, the British, of course, started to redouble their efforts to anglicize the island. And we have the start of a bitter political struggle, upholders of Italian versus supporters of English. In the process, the wily British introduced Maltese in conjunction with English to make it seem an exaggeration to have the third language Italian. And so we have the Maltese who favored English supporting the British, and the Maltese who retained their old identity of culture in Italian, being marginalized, as it were. And this language question lasted well into the first half of the 20th century. 1921 Constitution grants self-government, recognizing English and Italian as the official languages, and Maltese, it's not given a status, but it is said that, Maltese has to facilitate the needs of non-speakers of English and Italian. 1934, letters patent, Here, for the first time, Maltese appears as an official language along with the two others, English as the language of the administration, English and Maltese as the languages used in civil service, and Maltese is called the general language at the law courts. Maltese orthographic rules, which had been finalized in 1924, are given recognition in 1934. 1935, Maltese is made compulsory for employment in the civil service and entrance to university. 1937, the chair of Maltese is established at the university, and the language question is finally settled in the Second World War when Italian bombs started to being dropped over Malta. That was the end of it. The 1961 colonial constitution mentions English and Maltese as official languages, whereas the 1964 independence constitution establishes Maltese as the national language, Maltese and English as both official languages. The Republican constitution reaffirms the same position. In the constitution, there are no definitions either of national or official, but the list of official languages is in principle open-ended. We suspect that originally this was done to placate the remaining supporters of Italian, so giving them the hope that one day, if the situation changed, Italian might still be an official language. But in fact, this clause was availed of very recently when Maltese Sign Language became the third official language. Now, according to the Constitution, there's no obligation for bilingual communication by the administration, but the administration is required to reply in the same official language used by citizens in addressing it. So if I write to a government department in Maltese, I have a constitutional right to be replied to in Maltese. Except that, as happens, you will be seeing this, this is ignored, and so there were actually two official reminders of this constitutional obligation in 1989 and 1996. For the courts, since Italian had been the only preserve of the courts, there is a specific mention of Maltese being the language of the courts in the constitution. Parliament is left free to regulate its own procedures, and we will see that this is the Achilles heel of the linguistic situation, in fact. So the ousting of Italian was completed in 1964, but in fact, Italian continued to be popular from the late 1950s because we continued to receive Italian television, and in fact, in my generation, we were all basically trilingual even before we went to school to learn Italian. However, in the 1990s, when cable television was introduced, that was the downfall of Italian, in fact. Now, Maltese is spoken of as one language, but in fact, it is not a monolithic language. It's realized in a multitude of different varieties, and these are not simply accents. They're all differences on all linguistic levels. Every village core has a particular variety, and this is an important component of self-awareness and identity. You will see that this is not the villages, this is just the local council areas, so there, which would include also villages, and there you have to practically understand. Gozo there. So you have to understand that in those areas there will be two or three villages with their own little dialects. We did some research some years ago. Just in one village, we found five sub-dialect areas. A native of the village could tell, you know, this person comes from that side, this person comes from the other side, just by listening to how they spoke. It's quite remarkable, in fact. I'll hand over to Thomas now.
So, good morning, everyone. The only legislation document we have specifically for language is the Maltese Language Act, and we're going to have a look at it quickly. Everything started in 1995. The Maltese Language Board was set up. Albert was a member of this board. He is one of the brains of the architects of the Maltese Language Act himself. And this board was responsible to make recommendations for establishing a national council for the Maltese language, which was unanimously approved by Parliament and was set up in 2005. In 2004, the Maltese Language Act was enacted, and thereafter, the following year, the National Council was set up.
Yes, Thomas, allow me. It is a source of great pride for myself and the members of the board so many years ago that we were, academics, basically, but we were appointed by a nationalist administration. The succeeding Labour administration reappointed the same members, and then we had a third, because it was short-lived, 2 years only, and then the succeeding nationalist administration reappointed all the members. So for us, that was a certificate, you know, that our impartiality in terms of, it was a source of great satisfaction for us. I should also say that, as we say in English, between the cup and the lip, there is many a slip. Although, you know, we were the authors of the report, however, the text of the law, we had nothing to do with that. So, you know, the criticism which Thomas will be leveling at the law, please don't blame us.
It's good to mention as well that the National Council for the Maltese Language falls under the Ministry for Education. Now, within the Maltese Language Act, Maltese is regarded as a fundamental element of the national identity, an essential component of the national heritage, and a strong expression of the nationality of the Maltese. These, as you can see, are three strong statements with regards to Maltese as the national language. Unfortunately, these statements are non-enforceable exhortations, however. The Maltese Language Act states also that Maltese has to be given primary importance in both state and other schools, and Maltese should be widely used in education, broadcasting, the media, the law courts, and in political, administrative, economic, social, and cultural life. As I said, these are all non-enforceable. There is no elaboration in the Maltese Language Act on the meaning of official language. In 2004, Malta becomes a full member of the European Union, and Maltese is declared as one of the official languages of the EU. It's good to mention as well that we still do not have an adequate supply of interpreters for Maltese, but the supply for translators is quite good. Maltese regard the Maltese language as one of the key elements reflecting their identity. In fact, two surveys done by Malta Today, which is a local newspaper, one was held in 2013 and another one was held the following year, find that approximately 68% regard Maltese as one of the top markers of their identity. Here you can see a graphic representation of this. Language is the most factor which reflects their identity. Culture, food, and religion follow. And then there are other factors. However, the Maltese people regard Maltese English bilingualism as well as another important factor of their identity. Knowledge of English is highly desirable by Maltese, and there is an ever-growing trend to use English in child-directed speech, due also to the fact that, unfortunately, we still lack resources, digital resources for kids, apps, for instance, and YouTube channels and videos for children in Maltese. We find a lot of them in English online. Many educated Maltese speak Maltese and English, but read and write mostly in English. And this is an interesting and intriguing fact. Maltese tend to speak a lot the Maltese language. In fact, almost 95% claim that they speak Maltese according to the latest national census in 2011. But then they turn to English when they need to write something. It happens to me all the time. I'm, for instance, speaking to someone on the phone, over the phone, and he speaks to me in Maltese, but then in less than 5 minutes, he sends me an email, and that email is in English. This is very typical in Malta. Now, we're going to have a look at different domains with regards to language, and we're starting off with the public sphere in society. Although use of Maltese, as I have said, is widespread because Maltese is official, it's co-official with English, this provides an alibi for the continued use of English. Many find it an excuse to use English instead of Maltese because English is an official language and they're not breaching any law. Another common excuse is that we still lack a viable spell checker and a full-fledged online dictionary for Maltese. However, there is an ongoing project by the Institute of Linguistics at the University of Malta, which is developing a corpus, and that will lead to an online dictionary and a spell checker. And this is happening not only for Maltese, but also for Maltese English and for Maltese Sign Language, the three official languages, as we have said, in Malta. That is the interface of this ongoing project, of the online dictionary, the Dizionario Tal Malti, the Maltese dictionary. It's an ongoing project, as I have said, and we still do not have a full-fledged dictionary, but at least there's the interface and the work is going on, thanks to the Institute of Linguistics at the University of Malta. Official texts and brochures are often drafted in English first, and then, unfortunately, poorly translated into Maltese. Because of this, native idioms are being lost, and relaxification is on the increase through unnecessary use of English loanwords, catchphrases, and slogans. A case in point are those two adverts there, save the date, 6th November 2016. That is an advert issued by the president of Malta. It is advertising a fun run, which is an annual activity, an annual event. The office of the president uses an English slogan, One Nation, One Heartbeat, and there isn't any tentative to translate that into Maltese either. The main portal of the government of Malta is bilingual. Okay, that is the interface in Maltese, and that is the interface in English. However, there is a clear bias to use English because most of the time the English content is more updated than the Maltese content. Most of the rest government entity websites are primarily in English. That is, for instance, a screenshot from the website of the Planning Authority. Everything, as you can see, is in English. They even issue documents for consultation, for public consultation, in English only. And then they organize meetings for local people in Maltese, because they speak Maltese, and then everything is written in English. More government entity websites. That is the website of the Ministry for Education. This is the interface. The default interface is in English, as you can see. There is the language choice. There is the language button to change from English to Maltese. But when you choose, when you change the website into Maltese, that is what you get. The interface is there. They thinking of doing the website in Maltese, but there is no content at all. Another entity website, the public procurement, everything is absolutely done in English. The public procurement of the government of Malta, that is the website, and every document issued is only in English. This is an interesting example. Here we're trying to make a compromise. The interface is absolutely in English, solely in English. However, they upload articles and press releases in English or in Maltese. They're not bilingual. And when a press release is uploaded in English, it isn't uploaded in Maltese. And when a press release is uploaded in Maltese, most of the times it's only in Maltese. But the whole website, the interface of the website, is once again in English. That is the Ministry for the Social Dialogue. Mentalities, however, are slowly changing. Bilingual texts are being used in some sectors. For instance, the leading banks in Malta have their ATM interfaces, the automated machines, in both languages. They offer the choice to use English or Maltese. Large private companies most importantly are the telecommunications, the brewing and beverage industries, and the National Airline published their annual reports partially bilingual, also part of their corporate social responsibility. And this is a good thing to notice. Published material of public health campaigns is most of the time bilingual. It is either in Maltese or bilingual. The National Council for the Maltese Language is working a lot to influence this change. For instance, lately we worked on road signage and marking. Road signs started displaying local names of localities, and where we have two names, the local name and the international name, for instance, San Julian, St. Julian's, both names are being used.
In brackets,
yes. We even developed a particular font to be used for road markings, because until almost 2 years ago, every name was written without using the Maltese diacritics. Now they have the fonts, and they started using it. And also we have more signage in our public spaces being used bilingually. Infrastructure projects, we're always on the lookout to see what infrastructure projects are going to be done, and we contact the persons in charge so that we ensure that the public signage will be in English and in Maltese and in English. That is something we did, for instance, for the oncology center in Malta. All signage is bilingual, and these are other examples.
Up to a few months ago, Thomas Patch was the only full-time paid member of the National Council for the Maltese Language. The rest of us work out of our love for the language.
Mm-hmm. And that reflects a lot of in what we're saying. We even collaborate with Malta Public Transport to use bilingual signage and bilingual leaflets, which are disseminated to the public. And also electronic displays are using local toponyms. We organize public seminars to raise awareness on better use of Maltese. And we're very much delighted due to the encouraging participation we continuously have for these activities, for these events. We try to keep in touch with the public. We have a Facebook page, Il Consiglio Nazionale Italiano in Malta. We organize voluntary courses in Maltese for public service employees and also for educators working in both the public and private sectors. Each year, we organize a successful university part-time course in proofreading Maltese. Next year, we're starting the 12th edition, and we have 350 proofreaders now who successfully completed this course. We turn on to the legal context. Apart from the declaration Albert mentioned, that we have Maltese as the national language and the co-official language with English, Article 74 of the Constitution lays down that save as otherwise provided by Parliament, and this is important, save as otherwise provided by Parliament, because Parliament is given power to use the language needed for its procedures, every law shall be enacted in both Maltese and English, and the Maltese text shall prevail. This is seen, for instance, in the Public Service Commission Appointments Regulation, which provide for bilingual calls for application, and the Maltese version is prevailing there. However, unfortunately, the Interpretation Act, enacted in 1975, 11 years after the 1964 Constitution, allows the enactment in whole or in part of any bill in either language. The Product Safety Act, enacted in 2001, for instance, clearly intended for the transposition of EU directives, provides for subsidiary legislation to be in English only. And this is ironic, because within the EU institutions, they are developing terminology in Maltese. The documents are already translated in Maltese, but then the local legislation calls for subsidiary language to be in English only. This is due to technical, the usual excuse is due to technical terminology. Other examples, for instance, the Medicinal Products Building Regulation Act, Lifts Regulation, provide for for subsidiary language to be in either in Maltese in English or in English or both. The parent legal act is in both language, but then the subsidiary legislation can be in Maltese, in English, or in both. Other examples, for instance, the financial sector legislation, the Malta Standards Authority Act, Insurance Act, Company Act, provide for subsidiary language, even worse now, to be in English only. And worse than that, other legislations provide for the text to be in English only, and so the English text, obviously, is binding. A word about the court proceedings. The criminal code provides that Maltese is the language of the court. There's also the judicial proceedings use of the English Language Act, which provides for non-Maltese speakers of English during court hearings. Now, here, English is allowed to be used, obviously. And we have also the Notarial Professional Notarial Archives Act, which provides for notarial acts, even wills, to be in Maltese or in English.
A quick word about the role of Maltese in the church. As you may imagine, the Catholic Church has played a major role in public and private life for much of our history. And there's a constitutional declaration which proclaims the religion of Malta as the Roman Catholic Apostolic Religion. We don't have the Inquisition anymore, however. Yeah. In fact, just a few years ago now, homosexual marriage was introduced. No, two years ago.
2 years ago.
And our prime minister was boasting about it all over the world, I think. Formally, of course, you have Italian as basically the language of the church. But even at that early time, there was an awareness of the insufficiency of Italian in communicating with the masses, and we have early attempts to translate the Catechism in Maltese following the Council of Trent. So we still had the bishop's pastoral letters in Italian up to the 1920s, but Maltese becomes progressively used more and more in the life of the church. We had an extraordinary young priest who has now been canonized, our first saint, who founded a lay society for the teaching of catechism in all the parishes. In the 1930s, we also had the beginning of translations of the complete text of the Bible. And of course, with the Second Vatican Council, Maltese is the language of the liturgy.
Now we move to education, the primary and secondary levels. According to the NCF, National Curriculum Framework, which was published in 2012, Maltese and English are considered indispensable prerequisites for young people, together with mathematics, a science subject, and digital literacy. Just to give you a picture, 57% of Maltese pupils attend state schools, 29% attend church-run schools, and 14% go to independent schools. The NCF establishes roughly the same time allocation to the teaching of Maltese and English in state schools. Church and independent schools are encouraged to follow suit. However, we see that there is a clear utilitarian bias in favor of English as a key element to universal knowledge and culture at all levels of education. Interestingly, the latest language policy for the early years in Malta and Gozo, published this year, develops the idea of Maltese not only as a language of identity, but also as a means to word knowledge and vocabulary for young people. At secondary level, Maltese is seen to foster a sense of identity in the student, but utility of English is emphasized as a language for wider communication. We have three types of schools, as I said. The state schools tend to focus on Maltese and introduce English more gradually. Independent schools emphasize more on English, sometimes neglecting, unfortunately, Maltese. And church schools vary a lot, some stressing English, others focus on Maltese. Parents are at liberty to choose sending their children to any type of schools from the above. In general, at secondary level, preference is given to English as medium of instruction for scientific and technical subjects, and Maltese is used, widely used for humanistic areas of the curriculum. There is evidence of code switching, and this is very interesting, as a valuable pedagogical tool to establish a link between Maltese of certain groups of students and the English textbooks, because in Malta, each textbook is in English for most of the subjects. Code switching is a complex phenomenon. Perhaps you can say something about this.
Of course, as you know, there are a lot of studies on code switching. What exactly constitutes code switching, won't go into that, but basically it involves the use of two languages in a single utterance, sometimes from speaker to speaker or within the utterance of the speaker. So this is an example that changed food, cells. This is an example taken from a biology class. It happens all the time. There are sociolinguistic variables correlating even with the proportion of each language in the utterance.
Now we move to tertiary and higher education. Institute of Tourism Studies trains personnel in the travel, hospitality, and tourism industry due to the fact that tourism is a crucial importance industry for our country. Here at ITS, both official languages are general entrance requirements, while some courses specifically require English. English is the medium of instruction. There is also a component of hospitality and tourism English in most of the course programs offered by this institute. Part-time course in Maltese for foreign workers working in the hospitality industry is also being offered. We have also, in this level, the MCAST, Malta College of Arts, Science and Technology, which is a vocational education and training institution. It offers courses in three levels, from level 1 to level 7. It has three levels, foundation, technical, and university level. Here, both languages are official. For the MCAST University College, the third level here, QF 5 to 7, Maltese or English are the languages of instruction as appropriate for the students concerned. Language of assessment is English, except for areas of study involving use of Maltese. This is a direct implication that students in vocational courses in reality might not have full competence to operate with English only. University of Malta. In Malta, we only have one university till today, Maltese and English are both obligatory university entrance requirements for all Maltese citizens. However, a Maltese applicant may be allowed to offer another language instead of Maltese if, for valid reasons of residence or education abroad over a significant period of 4 years, is approved. Non-Maltese applicants are not obliged to present a qualification in Maltese.
The latest development now is that they've discovered autism in Malta, and the poor autistic students are regarded as so underprivileged that they cannot cope with more than one language, and guess which language that is, in spite of all the evidence that bilingualism doesn't affect autism. You know? This is our current battle just now. Just before leaving, I just missed a meeting of my colleagues with the rector of the university to try to show him that there is no reliable scientific evidence for the position he is taking. I will give you three guesses, just one guess, what his answer will be.
At university, English is the language of instruction, except obviously in language departments. Provision emphasized in view of the fact that there were complaints by international students that many lecturers code switch and they cannot follow lectures properly. Mm-hmm. English is the language of assessment and dissertations, where for some reason another language is used. An abstract in English is mandatory, but an abstract in Maltese is not required at all, and this also is leading in lack of terminology in different sectors. Since many Maltese cannot communicate effectively in English, The use of English is perpetuating, obviously, an injustice with Maltese clients of professionals graduating from our university. There is also an extensive use of code switching by doctors and other healthcare professionals, pharmacists, lawyers, notaries, with such clients. Foreign medical students and some other healthcare students are now required to take specialized courses in medical Maltese offered by the Department of Maltese within university.
We should, however, say that the original impetus for this noble gesture in trying to protect Maltese patients from professionals who couldn't communicate with them was the fright which Maltese doctors took at the prospect of European doctors feeling free to come and work in Malta, and so they thought that Maltese would be a convenient barrier. They even tried to, persuade the Department of Maltese to make the exam so difficult that nobody would pass. And we had to take a position that if we are offering a professional course, there has to be a reasonable chance for a student to pass.
So a quick word about the broadcast media. In general, in Malta, English American documentaries, films, cartoons, and adverts are common on state and private TV channels. However, drama productions, magazine programs, cooking, sport, current affairs, and discussion programs are highly popular in Maltese. Many professionals interviewed on TV and radio cannot avoid code switching during their interviews.
In fact, I have a theory that we now have a growing cohort of Maltese citizens whose native language is neither Maltese nor English because they cannot speak, solely in one language. They cannot, even when the situation requires it, in public on Maltese state television. They cannot.
There's still no obligation for interpretation or subtitling to be used. Radio and TV adverts are in English or in Maltese. And it's also a common practice for TV adverts to include spoken Maltese, that is narration, and written English in graphics. We even have some TV adverts relayed in Italian. Some local journalists, this is being continuous practice, a common practice now, ask questions in English in a press conference in Maltese, and then they are replied, it is in Maltese. Almost all radio stations transmit programs in Maltese, but their playlists include Maltese, English, and Italian music. One station, which used to broadcast solely in English, had to cease operations because of poor listenership. There are no quotas yet on music played on radio channels. The code on the correct use of the Maltese language on the broadcasting media regulations is the only legal document we have for Maltese monitoring. This code obliges producers and stations to have their own language consultant. However, this has been found not practical at all, and the code is being revised because one consultant for each station cannot cope and cannot monitor all the programs and its schedule. The new code is also tackling other lacuna, avoidance of unnecessary use of English words, use of Maltese fonts, attention to orthography, and other issues. Printed and digital media. In Malta, there are 4 daily newspapers, 2 are in Maltese and 2 in English, 8 weekly newspapers, 5 in Maltese, and 3 in English. The Maltese newspapers are associated with political parties, the newspapers in Maltese. This is a clear indication that Maltese is very efficient to reach out for the largest possible number of people. Political advertising, in fact, is predominantly in Maltese. There are also 9 online news portals. 4 are in Maltese, 4 in English, and 1 is bilingual. We're quite balanced here. Incentives for local broadcasters. The National Council for the Maltese Language sponsors 2 awards each year for print and digital media and broadcast media. We also organize seminars for broadcasters. With regards to citizenship, the Maltese Citizenship Act provides for an alien or a stateless person that he has an adequate knowledge of the Maltese or the English language. As you can see, this is not clear. There are no specific criteria to indicate what this adequate knowledge means. The family reunification regulations stipulate that the family members coming to reside to Malta may be required to attend and successfully complete courses in the Maltese language, whatever this may mean. The latest individual investor program of the Republic of Malta regulations do not provide for any linguistic requirement. Maltese immigrants are mainly found in Australia, the United Kingdom, the US, the USA, and Canada. Many second-generation individuals, unfortunately, lost their Maltese. There's also in Malta a Council for Maltese Living Abroad, which is also responsible to the teaching of Maltese as a foreign language. In addition, with the EU membership, many Maltese live in Brussels and Luxembourg. These have limited opportunities to send their children to European schools and learn Maltese as one of the EU official languages. With regards to the last domain, culture, literature, and the arts, our council works with other four local NGOs, the Accademia Talmalti, Academy of Maltese, the Ada Talmalti Università, this is the Association of University Students, the Ada Poeti Malti, Maltese Poets Association, and the Ada Area Talprofi Talmalti, the Association for Proofreaders of Maltese. There's also a literary prize for both Maltese and English literary works. We have also a national literacy agency within the Ministry of Education, which is offering various bilingual literacy programs in different localities in Malta and Gozo. As you can see from this review, the tension between the de jure and de facto realities leaves much to be desired in the status of Maltese as the national language. Shared official status with English often results in Maltese being sidelined because of the excuses I mentioned before. However,
Maybe we can see a silver lining in the cloud. Our conclusion would be that the position of Maltese would have been much worse without its accorded national status in the constitution, enhanced also by the Maltese Language Act, for what it's worth. However, bolstered also by its recognition as one of the official languages of the EU. Thank you.
Grazie.